Five. Five. Now that can't be right. Wait.
Yeah.
Well, how about that? You're right. Yeah. Well, somebody's really angry with Stalin. Uh-huh. Bye. July 4th, 1941. Operation Barbarossa, Germany's invasion of the Soviet Union, began last week, and Germany took tons of territory as the panzers surged forward. But already this week, a new wrinkle is emerging. When they're so far forward, how do you supply them? I'm Indy Neidell. This is World War II. Last week, Germany invaded the Soviet Union, as I said, and took loads of land and caused heavy casualties in just a few days. Damascus fell to the Allies, and Claude Auchinleck replaced Archie Wavell in command of the Middle Eastern Theater of British Operations. Rana Mitter states that the summer of 1941 marks a real shift in the geopolitics of the war. It might be hard to think that's not an understatement. The conflicts in the East and the West have been self-contained for the most part so far, but Barbarossa confronts Japan with the choice of whether or not to also attack the Soviet Union. There are some, like Foreign Minister Yosuke Matsuoka, who do advocate such a move, but the Army and Navy are against helping Germany, at the very least, until they have drawn substantial numbers of Soviet troops from Siberia to Europe. On the second, Japan has an imperial conference, a meeting of Japanese government and military leaders and the emperor to explain policy to the emperor and nominally to take important decisions. In fact, these are already taken at the liaison conferences between the politicians and the military leaders. The decision is recorded that they will try to expand southward, first establishing military bases in Indochina, even at the risk of war with Britain or the United States. The United States knows of this fairly quickly because, as we've seen, they've cracked the major Japanese diplomatic code and even some minor operational codes. Indochina is, in theory at least, under Vichy French control. But those guys are taking a hit elsewhere this week. On the 1st, the Hab force wins the Battle of Palmyra. The British mechanized cavalry have a sharp battle with the Vichy forces, who retreat, but then find themselves boxed in a valley. They surrender. And this is disheartening enough for the 3rd Light Desert Company, who garrisoned Palmyra, to also surrender. The Hab force after that makes for Homs to threaten Vichy communication along the coast. Also in the Syrian campaign, on the 1st, elements of General Slim's 10th Indian Division cross into Syria from Iraq. And on the 3rd, those troops win the Battle of Deir ez-Zor. I said last week that Claude Auchinleck was going to take over command of Britain's Middle Eastern Theater of Operation, and this he does on the 1st. Also, since Middle East Command has had to deal with a lot of political stuff in the past, Oliver Littleton is appointed Middle Eastern Minister of State June 28th to deal with all of that. That is not the only news around the Mediterranean this week. The Australians lose their first warship of the war this week to enemy action when German dive bombers sink the Water Hen off Sidi Barani as it makes its way to Tobruk with supplies for the men under siege. The Australians pretty quickly avenge this, though, when the Sydney sinks the Italian cruiser Bartolomeo Colleoni. And here are June totals for the Battle of the Atlantic. German U-boats sink 61 ships for 310,000 tons. There is a drop in shipping sunk by planes because of the air power Germany diverted for invading the Soviet Union. Total Allied losses are 109 ships for 432,000 tons. The first escort carrier, Audacity, enters British service. The Allies are making things more difficult for the U-boats. Radar that works on the 10-centimeter wavelength is slowly entering service. In good conditions, it can pick up a periscope at a kilometer away. Actually, people are working on all kinds of inventions. This month, the Maud Committee will report that they think it will be possible to make an atomic bomb from the isotope uranium-235. They also discuss using uranium as a power source and not just for a bomb. The British move to set up a more permanent nuclear research program codenamed Tube Alloys. Wallace Akers is the director, and it is he who chooses the deliberately misleading codename, which is used by everyone who refers to the project. But let's look at the big codename, Barbarossa, and see how it's progressing this week. On June 28th, 6 days after the invasion began, Advanced German units are one-third of the way from the border to Moscow. The tenacity of the Soviets is, however, being remarked upon by the Germans. Chief of Staff Franz Halder notes in his diary that they are fighting to the last man, and Völkischer Beobachter, the Nazi Party newspaper, writes on the 29th, "The Russian soldier surpasses our adversary in the West in his contempt for death. Endurance and fatalism makes him hold up until he is blown up with his trench or falls in hand-to-hand fighting." That day comes a directive from Moscow for the army. When withdrawing from a town, leave nothing usable behind. Certainly nothing like rolling stock for trains or animals like cattle, but even down to food. Not a loaf of bread, not a liter of fuel. If you can't remove it, destroy it. Total scorched earth policy. The directive also calls for partisans behind enemy lines to work at blowing up bridges, railway tracks, destroying enemy telephone and telegraph communications, blowing up enemy ammunition dumps. Posters of the German deserter Alfred Liskov, who, as we saw, warned the Soviets of the impending attack a day before it happened, are put up around Leningrad with the caption, "A mood of depression rules among German soldiers." In the field, the Germans are closing the Bialystok-Minsk cauldron with well over 300,000 Red Army troops encircled within. Sources differ on exact numbers. Hermann Hoth from the north and Heinz Guderian from the south advance with their panzer groups. Still, Hoth writes to his army group center commander Fedor von Bock that the battle this day is a lot more difficult than anything so far for his 20th Panzer Division, and his 7th has lost so many of its tanks in just the first week that it needs to be reinforced from the 20th. And Guderian has had to divert a mechanized division to Gunther von Kluge's 4th Army that's following behind him to contain the cauldron and secure the rear, and he does not like this. Guderian and Kluge have a strong personal dislike for each other, but even beyond that, the distance between Guderian's 2nd Panzer Group and the 4th Army is already such that it's going to be a real chore for Kluge to secure Guderian's supply lines stretched out in front of him for endless kilometers. So we're really seeing the problems created by two overall army speeds, one on wheels and one on foot or maybe horse. Bock is also accusing Kluge of stalling. When Guderian also has to send his 10th Panzer Division to Kluge, he's even less happy, but that pales in comparison to how he feels about the possibility that both panzer groups may soon be put under Kluge's command. David Steil notes that the problems here are not about prestige, but a fundamental difference in strategy and operations. Kluge wants to close the pocket as tightly as possible to take the most prisoners. Guderian wants to keep up the rapid spearhead advance and move to the next objective to keep the enemy off balance. You can't do both. Halder is adamant that Army Group Center's first objective is Minsk, but he wants to already send panzers forward towards the Dvina and the Dnieper. On the 29th, he writes for the first time in his diary what he's said and hinted at for months, that his objective for Army Group Center is Moscow. On the 30th, though, Adolf Hitler explains how he wants a move towards Leningrad and the Baltics, and only after taking Leningrad's industry should they launch an attack against Moscow. Hitler's also worried that they're overextending at Bobruisk, so he issues orders that Army Command cannot order the panzers to attack further eastward. Halder thinks this is a big mistake, but writes in his diary that he hopes the mid-level commanders will do the right thing anyhow without orders. They close the Minsk pocket the 29th, but it's anything but tightly sealed, and huge numbers of Red Army troops simply marched through the gaps in the German lines. That's Army Group Center. We saw last week that Erich von Manstein's panzers in the north are stopped, waiting for their infantry to catch up. And in the south, the going is slow in general against well-organized and well-led Red Army units. The activity in the northern and southern army groups illustrates the interdependence of each sector on the progress of the war as a whole. Even in this initial period of the war, the inability of the armies to maintain contact between neighboring units simultaneously, pacify the rear areas, and provide infantry support to the panzer spearheads speaks strongly of the army's overextension, which was already becoming apparent. Steil actually has a few good observations of this week of the offensive, and I like his conclusion about the Minsk operation. While there can be no doubt that the encirclement of Pavlov's Western Front represented a calamity for the Red Army, it was by no means the one-sided victory commonly portrayed. The southern flank of the pocket hemorrhaged like an open wound for the Germans. In addition, merely creating the vast pocket taxed German strength considerably. See, this has just been phase one, and it worked with the panzers being so mobile and having at least some infantry support. But that's mainly because they had the same rough starting points. The panzers are soon going to race ahead, and the infantry is now far behind and having to deal with the surrounded Soviet forces. Halder, of course, needs to organize the panzers, so he's stopping them till the 5th, though he will change that to the 3rd. That day, a memorandum goes out to Army Group Center noting that there will soon be stretches of hundreds of kilometers behind the panzer groups with no German troops in them. They will literally be sending a big chunk of their army straight into enemy territory with no support or infantry to secure things. And the panzer supply columns, the trucks, and the things crossing that gap would be the elements most at risk. The Finns and the Germans now begin Operation Arctic Fox. This is part of Operation Silver Fox to capture Murmansk. Last week, Operation Reindeer secured the Petsamo nickel mines. Operation Platinum Fox is launched on the 29th to secure the Rybaki Peninsula. And Arctic Fox the First launching a frontal attack on Soviet positions in Salla. The German troops are untrained for Arctic forest warfare, so it doesn't go well from the outset. They do also begin Operation Salmon Trap against the Kandalashka-Belomorsk railway line, and German and Finnish attacks begin in Karelia, even as the evacuation of over 200,000 children from Leningrad begins. That's 5 Finnish operations. Germany has 1, Barbarossa, with 3 million people attacking on a 1,500-kilometer front. The Finns have 5 this week. I don't know why I find that amusing, but I did find that amusing. Okay, anyhow. On the 30th in the south, General Mikhail Kirponos orders the withdrawal from the Lvov salient to the line Korosten-Novgorod-Shepatovka-Starokonstantinov-Proskurov. German Army Group South takes Lvov and other units make advances towards Kiev. On the 1st, the Germans capture Riga. Other units are well beyond the Dvina, heading for Ostrov. This day, a train with 2 passenger cars and 22 freight cars heads east from Leningrad. It contains many of the great treasures of the Hermitage. Rembrandts, Raphaels, Rubens, El Greco, and more. It is not just paintings and sculpture, but a huge collection of gold, diamonds, and jewels. German Foreign Minister Joachim von Ribbentrop asks the Japanese to attack the Soviets from the east, but they refuse, having already made their decision. The Soviet spy Richard Sorge will radio that intel from Tokyo to Moscow next week. And as a result, the Red Army will continue to bring reinforcements from the Far East without worry of an attack there. On the 2nd, the Romanian 3rd and 4th Armies and German 11th Army begin large-scale attacks. These attacks make it urgent to relocate the factories of the southwestern part of the Soviet Union. And on the 3rd, the State Defense Committee orders the transfer of 26 more armament factories eastward. Also on the 3rd, the Bialystok pocket surrenders. And at the front, Army Group Center's advance towards Dnipro-Dvina begins again, aiming at Smolensk. More on this next week. Halder writes in his diary the 3rd, "It is no exaggeration to say that the campaign in Russia has been won in 14 days. There is also now the restructuring in Army Group Center that I said might happen. The 2nd and 3rd Panzer Groups under Huth and Guderian that had plowed ahead and created the Minsk Cauldron are now subordinate to Kluge's 4th Army, which was all the infantry and support. As I said, Kluge and Guderian can't stand each other, so that's going to be fun. Kluge gives up all but 2 of his infantry corps to Maximilian von Weich's 2nd Army, and the overall thing is now Kluge's 4th Panzer Army. Kluge is much more cautious about racing ahead than Guderian." Joseph Stalin publicly announces this day the scorched earth policy. He does this in his first radio broadcast since the invasion began. He calls for total war effort and guerrilla warfare in the territory lost. One thing here. Although we cover atrocities and war crimes in our War Against Humanity series, I should point out that from the beginning of Barbarossa, the cruelty behind the lines was already reaching new levels of brutality. On the 4th, as the week ends, one of Heinrich Himmler's special task forces notes the murder of 463 Jews in Kovno. 2,500 more will die within a couple of days. In Tarnopol, Zborov, Vilna, and more, dozens and then hundreds of Jews are murdered as the days progress. As the week ends, the Vilna ghetto is established and the professors of Lvov are massacred. The week ends on the 4th of July, American Independence Day. President Franklin Roosevelt says the U.S. will never survive as a happy and fertile oasis of liberty surrounded by a cruel desert of dictatorship. Earlier in the week on the 1st, all men over 21 in the United States must register for the draft. And so the week ends, with decisions made for new operations in Japan, scattered action in Syria and at sea, and the relentless progress of the German army in the Soviet Union. Martin Gilbert writes, "The cohorts and collaborators of the Germans did their own killing. It was not only Ukrainians and Lithuanians who had begun to kill Jews. In Norway, Josef Terboven ordered the roundup of all Jews in Tromsø and the northern provinces. They were deported to Germany. Other Jews arrested in Trondheim were shot. From Holland on June 30th, another 300 young Jews were rounded up and deported to the stone quarries of Mauthausen. But in the Soviet Union, the troops taken prisoner were not protected by any stipulations of the Hague Convention. Part of the Commissar decree that I did not read last week says, German soldiers guilty of breaking international law will be excused. Russia has not participated in the Hague Convention and therefore has no rights under it, because, you know, otherwise they'd be really nice to the POWs. So already now we see that it's not only commissars who get the works. For many of the young men in the Wehrmacht have grown up indoctrinated with the anti-Bolshevism of National Socialism. And it is murder. That's the word for it. At this point, though, it's only the Germans who are privy to the secret of just how badly they plan to treat any Soviets who fall into their hands. At this point. If you'd like to see those War Against Humanity episodes that I mentioned, you can check out the playlist right here. Our Time Ghost Army member of the week is Neil O'Shea. It is thanks to people like Neil that we can continue to make content like this in troubled times like these. So please support us at patreon.com or timeghost.tv. Do not forget to subscribe and ring that bell. See you next time.